future candy innovation consultants and trend spotters. As the name implied, they take a very close look at things, innovations, products that will delight our customers in the months and years to come. So we're very pleased to have joining us on the stage, Roman from Future Candy. If you'll join us, Roman.
Welcome.
Let's shape the future. I'm waking up to the Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the digital transformation. I'm very happy to be here, Monaco, with you today. And if I look into your faces, I see you had a rough night last night, which is good, right? Because we are here to create and shape the future. That's also what I want to talk about. I want to talk about the digital new wave, right? How things, how innovations are pushing our business models. It's nowadays, it's not us moving forward, it's technology is moving forward, and we're basically moving with the speed with it, or we are being drawn. We're like kind of the carrot running from the next technology wave, and it's hitting us wave after wave after wave, and it's not stopping. Because if there's one certain, that change will always happen, always, forever. Change after change after change, like waves. That's how technology rolls in. There's never gonna be a time in your life again where you can sit down and say, I mastered my model, I mastered my business, now it's time to relax. This will not happen again. So where are we right now in this digital transformation age, right? Unfortunately, in Europe, we're a little bit behind, or at least we feel like we are behind, because all these innovations are happening all over the world, and sometimes it's lacking here a little bit, right? And that's what we are here for, because we at Future Candy, we believe that we can show the Silicon Valley and the San Francisco how to move forward, how to create new stuff. And the message, so to say, is have no fear, shape the future. When you think about it a little bit, in the times where we are, it's kind of like 1992, and imagine the internet was just invented, and nobody had a single clue where this is gonna go. And this is kind of, we're still in the same age. We have something like the internet. All these technology waves coming in, but we have no idea yet how they will impact us and how the future will look like. We try to anticipate, but always from our view right now, right? But at the end, it's a blank sheet, a blank white piece of paper that we need to write and that we need to connect the dots and where we need to get stuff done. Right, so when we have a little outlook about how things may look, right? We all heard about augmented reality, virtual reality, augmented world. You wake up, put on your glass, your contact lens, whatever it is, get information right and visible into your view. You have like the Klitschko sports program to wake up, to get moving. Of course, all your movements are tracked, so you know at the end of the day, you know how healthy are you. Your kids are gonna learn right at the dinner table in an interactive, multi-conventional way, or play games when the dad is not around. And you know, the world becomes your playground. You don't need a TV or a tablet. Everything is a playground, right? And the cool thing, it's also gonna be smart. My kids are tracked. I know how much they run, how much they don't run, and I can assemble food according like more protein or more carbohydrates. You know, if I see my kids are not running enough, they're not moving enough, they're gonna get different food. Or maybe the program is going to adjust food. Workspace is everywhere. Already nowadays, whether I'm in San Francisco or here, my workspace is here, right? I can travel around with my workspace. And similar, when we have holograms and all these kind of innovations out coming out, you know, it's gonna be even more fun, right? Because it's gonna be three-dimensional. And you think, it's a little bit far away, far-fetched, what is he talking about, animated video? Now, you all know that Microsoft, that company that helps us work with Outlook and all this kind of stuff, they're working on HoloLens, which is virtual reality glasses, and they augment your reality. And you can already buy the product, it's for developer release, because also Microsoft has no idea what the technology is doing. They have no idea, and they don't care. They put it out and let the masses adapt and create software and create the future. That's not done by Microsoft. Microsoft just puts out the technology, and the rest is done by others. Same with Apple. Apple is not doing 2 billion apps. People are doing it. People are creating the content, and that's what these technology waves are doing. They're just pushing it forwards, and then it's up to us, to all of us, to move forward with these things, and that's gonna enhance our lives. Or it can create new shopping worlds, right, where you can experience why did Facebook buy Oculus Rift, this virtual reality function? What are their plans with it? Maybe they didn't know when they bought Oculus Rift, but they knew this is going to be big, this is going to be important. Let's do something with it. Or I love this, the whole drone industry and autonomous cars. I put them together because what they're doing, they are doing a trend, like a really important change here. So far on our mobile phone, I have information accessible everywhere at any time. Now with drones, with autonomous cars, I'm going to have objects accessible every time, anywhere, wherever I am, right? So imagine nowadays, if you want to buy something, you go on Amazon, and the next day you have it in your letterbox, at your address. Already in San Francisco, with Amazon Prime Now, you can already order goods, and you have them within 1 hour. They deliver it to you. Well, still by people, they still drive cars, but imagine what happens when you have autonomous cars or drones that can just send stuff from A to B. And when we talk about autonomous cars, like, we still picture them, these vehicles, you know, with like 2 seats in the back and 2 in the front. Like, who needs this? An autonomous car can just be a box that delivers your pizza or whatever you just want. But we don't know yet. We have to find out. We just know have the technology of something that moves around in streets that doesn't need any person, that can move safely. That's all we need, and the rest will be done and will be decided by us. How do we get our goods across and to the person? But imagine what that means for your business, for your retail space maybe. You know, if I don't even need to tell where I live, I need to tell Amazon where I'm going to be in 1 hour, and then they just bring me whatever I want. So why are we talking about this? Right? Because it's going to change everyone's life always. The digital transformation is happening, and it's cool. You shouldn't fear it. It may be challenging your business model, but I mean, our little gray cells, you know, they like to be challenged. And we're humans. Our species can adapt to a lot of stuff. And sometimes we wonder ourselves, when you look at H&M, they do great clothes, have great retail space everywhere, but why do they suck in online retail? Why is that? And nobody knows. Why do all the bookstores, why did they suck in delivering books to me at home? Why do they do this? They have the knowledge. Why do companies like Zappos, like Zalando, companies that didn't exist just a couple of years ago, disrupt this old industry that has been out for centuries and ages? And why? Because technology is changing so quickly. I mean, you've probably all seen that photo when the Pope got elected in 2005 and 2013. That's how it changed. Right, because what happened in between, the iPhone was invented, just as a little thing. All these people had cell phones before, but not like this. The technology that we have in our pocket right now is way better than the technology they had when they landed people on the moon. And these stores are not around anymore. Where do you want to rent a video? Or a VHS, you know, like they started with VHS and they said, now we're gonna have DVD. And then they thought, cool, now we're gonna have the Blu-ray. Now we can charge a little bit more on better quality. But no, bullshit, who wants the Blu-ray? Nobody needs the Blu-ray, because at home, I have everything. It's in the air, every movie, anytime, wherever I am. Netflix is building now a global market. Whether I have my account in the US and I come to Germany or to Monaco, I can watch every movie whenever I want. I don't need to go to a store. I don't need to do this. And also, as it was mentioned, you know, taxi transformation with Uber. But it's even more, like the whole transportation here is absolutely changed with Lyft and Sidecar and Uber, three companies that are battling right now in San Francisco. For me as a consumer, I love it because I can choose. They do have a big price battle. So companies that are so young and they're already battling in prices. And the cool thing is they're becoming more and more innovative because they have to. They can't stand still. Uber, Lyft, Sidecar, they have to move. So Uber, we all know what they're doing. And Lyft, you all know about it as well. But now they start offering these pool or lines where I can join other riders. I want to go from A to B. Maybe somebody else wants to go from near A to near B. And so we ride along. What does it mean for carbon footprint and, of course, for the price? I go in San Francisco from one side to the other for $5, for $5, if I allow somebody else to join the ride. May take a little bit longer, but they're doing a really good job. So that's what's happening. Sidecar is actually not around anymore because they couldn't fight this battle between Lyft and Uber. So what they did is they said, okay, now we're going to transport food. We're not going to do people anymore. We're going to do goods and food because the technology they created can be used for anything, right? And this is how things happened, right? And your industry will be transformed as well, but it's nothing bad, right? You just got to participate. You just got to take part of it. And that's where I want to help you a little bit about, because those people are doing it if you're not doing it. And they love doing it. And why do they love doing it? Because the crumb of your cake is awesome. It's fucking amazing for them. And how do we know this? Because I'm an entrepreneur. I founded two companies. And the first day I make $1 million revenue, I'm going to open champagne bottles. Like $1 million revenue for you, maybe nothing. You know, maybe you do that in a week, maybe in a month. Maybe you need to do a couple of million. Maybe you need to do a billion. But for me, $1 million is a lot. But after 1 million comes 2 million, then 4 million, then 8 million, 16 million, and then I grow like hell. And there are companies out there that hire 30 people every week, right? And their problem is not money, is not growth, is not product. Their problem is hiring talents. 30 people every week. Imagine what that means for your company culture. And you haven't heard of this company, probably Anaplan. And maybe you've never heard of them. And why is it so easy? Because it has never been so easy to found a company, to start a company. And when I went to university, we talked about business plans, like a 30-page business plan. And the funkiest thing about a business plan is when you are at page 30, page 1 to 10 are already obsolete. Right? Because it changes so much. And your thoughts change. Your business changes, especially in the beginning where everything is on your mind. Everything changes. So all you need nowadays for a new business, for a new idea, for a new product is this simple one-pager. Right? I work with this. I have a couple of whenever I have an idea, I quickly fill out what is the problem that I have that I'm trying to solve. What is my solution? How is that going to look like? What are some key metrics where they see whether the product is viable or not? And of course, what's my value proposition? And I can collect these things and I can analyze, I can adapt, I can change anytime. And when like a couple of months, when I look back at it, the whole thing has changed and I can quickly do it. A business plan, horrible to adapt a business plan. So if you're interested in this, check out Lean Canvas. You'll find this. It's really cool for new businesses, for ideas, at least to get started. This is like my eye-opener graphic, right? When you look about the companies and the valuation in billion, right? Apple, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook, with hundreds of billion-dollar valuation. And those giants like Daimler or Siemens or BMW, Volkswagen, they're like little midgets. Like, why should Apple buy Daimler? I mean, there's also all the other long tail attached to it. It doesn't make sense, right? They're just too small. And that's what's happening, and that's where we are. I think this is very opening. When you're in an old industry, you're probably on the lower part than on the upper part. And the good thing is transformation is always possible, right? So what does that mean for you? It's for your system. Maybe we can look a little bit quickly into Silicon Valley, what people are doing, and maybe adapt a few things. And that's also why I'm here, to show you a little bit when I started out in San Francisco, what I had to learn in a very tough way. So I give you a little run back. Who am I? What did I do? And why do I think I can talk about this? So in 2011, I had a cool idea, or I thought I had a cool idea, and kind of like actors go to LA, I went to San Francisco with my founding team. We raised a little bit of money, we started on our products, and we built two products, and we're building our third one right now, just roughly. So we wanted to disrupt the, not disrupt actually, because the market didn't exist and never existed, still doesn't. We wanted to build a couples app, right? So we thought Facebook for friends, and Twitter for strangers, and LinkedIn for colleagues, so why not something for couples? Anyways, didn't work out. Second is we went into secure communication. We are building an app, Darkroom, which is basically creating a secure communication, kind of cache to cache, never stored on a server. So it's interesting here is that the feedback from this consumer product was so big by businesses that we said, oh, that's cool. When businesses, how do they communicate horribly? Email, maybe WhatsApp groups if they're really bad. So why not make them build a product? Right now we're calling it Vault. We don't even have the real name yet. But if you're interested, you can sign up at vault.chat if you want to have secure business communication in the future. So that's what I've been building for the past 3 years, these products. And of course, a lot of adaptation when you look from couples to chat to business to a B2B product. And why is that? Because we're driven by innovation and we're driven by change. And especially in Silicon Valley, it's like always give up. Like you fail, you just get up and try the next one. You start the next company, or you go start the next product, as long as you still have some ants in your pants, you know, you're just going to get going. And why Silicon Valley, and why do I believe that if I would have the same road in a different city, I would not be speaking to you now as an entrepreneur or somebody who owns stake in company? I would probably be back in business working for a larger corporation or whatever. Because the Silicon Valley gets me moving. It makes me not stopping. There are special traits about the Silicon Valley. Number one, obviously, is the infrastructure. The infrastructure in Silicon Valley and San Francisco is so big, the knowledge of everything is so there that I can found a company within 2 days, I have my bank account. When we founded our second company, it was literally calling the lawyer, hey, we're going to found the company. Let's do this. 2 days later, we had our bank account and our credit cards on the third day. They arrived. They take a little bit longer to deliver. And the coolest thing is we didn't pay a single cent to the lawyer. Why? Because the infrastructure is set in a way that it's so founder-friendly that they work on deferred fees. The lawyer, or all our lawyers actually, the patent lawyer, the corporate lawyer, they only get money when we are successful. That sounds like a weird business model because we all know 7 out of 10 businesses fail. So most likely, by odds, our lawyer is not going to get any money from us. Right? But there's the hope and there's the possibility to make a whole lot of money out of it, right? And that's what drives them. And this infrastructure is set there, and those people know that I should not pay $10,000 in a lawyer. It's important that I pay $10,000 into the product, into my vision, into my company. That's what I need to do. Of course, talent, big thing, because like moths fly to the light, people with entrepreneurial spirits or programmer or everyone who can code tries to go there because obviously there's a lot of money to make, but also a lot of passion on side products and everything is possible. So it attracts a lot of talent. And of course the money, right? That's very important. I could talk a whole talk about money, but I'm keep it short here. Money is available, but it's not dumb money. This is what sometimes in Europe, when we look at it, these high valuations, people think like, oh my God, the bubble's gonna burst. And maybe it will, maybe it won't. But what's really interesting and what's really important that the money that is invested in San Francisco and Silicon Valley stays there because entrepreneurs get the money and they do not go on their yacht afterwards and celebrate. They start the next business, fund the next business. It always keeps moving. People don't party hard. People work hard. A little bit of parties there as well, especially if you have a big exit or if you get something done. But it's really cool how the money circulates. It never really drains out. So all of these factors are very important. But those factors you can put anywhere in the world, right? You can put the money, you can put with the money, you can get the talents, and you can set up the infrastructure. So that's what people try to do everywhere in the world. But there's one big difference in that what I believe is very strong in San Francisco, and I've never felt it anywhere else in the world. And that is just the big network effect and the knowledge of everything. When I have a problem, no matter what stage or where I am in my company, there are going to be tons of people who have had this problem already. To show you a little bit, so in the first company, Twixt, when our CEO and co-founder, when he left the company, and shortly afterwards, our CTO also left the company, and on top of that, we almost ran out of money. Our bank account was just like shrinking like a roller coaster going downwards. And in this day, when our CTO, when he quit, I had a meeting with somebody I met at an event before, and I was like, okay, I'm going to get drunk today. Like, this is, you know, like, your company is going downhill. You have no idea how to get out of it. Self-pity right here. I'm going to get drunk. So I met with him, and I still remember it exactly the way when he asked me, how are you doing? And I tried to get on my rant, you know, how bad everything is, how horrible everything is going for me at the moment. You know, I just see him when I told him, yeah, my CEO left, and I still remember him, how he like took a sip of his beer. Oh, don't worry, that happened to me already twice. And we started talking about how we're going to attack this, how we're going to attack this problem. Like, my self-pity was gone. And as you learn later on, self-pity doesn't help you, doesn't move you forward. It doesn't. It just, I don't know, I don't even know why we have self-pity. So get rid of it and just start moving. And whenever you feel a challenge, just do it. You got to learn, you got to move forward. And the cool thing is you can always hack everything, right? So when we think about how most likely, maybe some of you guys in companies, how you work in long developing cycles, whether it's a product or a software product or whatever, you know, first you have the ideation, then you start a little bit on validating, you do the design, you do the coding, and then the testing. And sometimes if you just want to renew the web page, or if you just want to renew your home page, it might take over a year or 2 years until you're finally, now my page is done. And if you have a service, maybe even a simple database, whatever it is, it may take you ages until it gets done. And what is the bad thing about it? That the minute you plan and the minute you release it, it has everything has already changed. You know, who knows what Apple is cooking up right now? You know, who knows what next phone Google is coming out, right? So that's why in the startup world, we don't have this. We have a little bit of resources. I maybe, if I get really lucky in a very early stage, I might get $500,000 from an investor. I may get this, and then I have to, within this $500,000, I have to do everything. I have to see, is my product viable? I have to build it, I have to test it, I have to run it, and I have to grow it. And that is not always very easy. It is easier nowadays, but luckily there are ways and tools of helping me, like the Lean Startup methodology or design thinking. So if you're interested in these, look it up. It's really cool and really helpful. Because the most important thing is just to make, that's the sign at Stanford University, and I think it really shows what it is. It's not about, nothing is a mistake, nothing. The only mistake may would be is if you don't do anything, right? But there's only make and nothing else. So the cool thing is you can always fake it to make it. That's one, the go-to say for a startup guy is like, I may not be able to promise you whatever I try to, but at least I have to fake it. I can hack it. Because before I build the whole infrastructure, before I build a whole warehouse, maybe I need to figure out, do you even want what I want? Do you even want what I want to offer you, right? So how to hack, my favorite hacking case is Zappos, right? The online shoe retailer in the US. So when you think about selling shoes online, they were not the first company who sold shoes online, right? Not at all. But they were the first company who thought, whose main mission was, how can I sell shoes to people? And he didn't do it by building a warehouse, expensive website, and creating a lot of shoes. What he did is he ran to every shoe store in Las Vegas. That's where he's from. He ran into the shoe stores and took photos of the shoes. And then he sent them online. And if somebody would purchase them, he would go to the store, buy the shoes, and then mail it to the person who bought the shoes. That might sound stupid you, but in, like, what was he able to do? He was able to learn how to sell shoes and talk with customers, with clients. What are their concerns? How should it be done? Should I first send the shoes, or should I send two pairs of shoes? Do I need to return? How should my return policy look like? All these really important questions he figured out before he invested a single dollar in a warehouse or in purchasing shoes beforehand. And then once the system was running, then you just go to a shoe store and say, like, hey, do you want to, I'm going to sell my shoes. You can grow this out of it. You can fake it to make it. You don't have to have all the shoes in there, right? So if you want to, later on we're going to have a workshop where we can also discuss more of these topics out here, because I think it's also going to be interesting for you when we can get more in a discussion, right? So we at Future Candy, that's what we're trying to do, right? Helping you with digital transformation, with the work that we can all do together. Because as I said, don't fear the future. It's really cool, right? We can do so much. Learning is the most fun part of it. I mean, we're all smart people here, and we all know how important learning is. And if we stop learning, we kind of stop living. And that's also where we can always help, and where together we can really create these things, right? Where when we share our experience, once we openly talk about our failures, about our successes, we can suddenly, we don't need to reinvent the wheel 5 times, 8 times. We just invented once. And then we talk about it, and with the media that is ubiquitous out there and the information, this is what we can do, right? So if you want to also, you can visit us in San Francisco, right? When you take out our, whenever you, maybe you visit Silicon Valley sometimes, or we offer some travels where you can join us on a trip and visit all these company and see some crazy stuff, some cool stuff, and some sad stuff, part of it. And yeah, so please do that. Also, visit Stanford and all these places. I think it's a great experience to know what's happening. Also, if you want to experience technology, if you want to have the technology in your hands, we can send them to you in a tech flat rate. So instead of just information, we send you the gadgets and you can play with it, because it's also important not only to put a VR, a virtual reality glass, just on your head and then, oh yeah, that's nice, it's funny. Have it in your office, play around with it. Let your mind go crazy on what can be possible. And don't hold back, because that's the other problem. Like, speak whatever you think, as crazy as it is, share your experience, right? I think that's very important. So to sum this up, right, I have like 3 key learnings for you that I want you to take home, and not only home, also to this talk today and the whole day at the distri. Like, embrace the future. Don't fear it. It's the coolest thing in the world. Or just look at our phones. That's just amazing, right? And it's just moving forward. It's not going back. And don't fear it. Yes, we have this tendency of, oh my God, what's happening? But let's not do it. Let's embrace the future and never stop learning. Let's keep on moving. Let's keep on adapting what's happening. Look here, look there. See what's valuable for us, what's not, right? Pick and choose. We can't do this. We have the luxury of pick and choose. So let's do this. Never stop learning. And of course, celebrate the openness. Secrets don't help anyone. Secrets don't help you. Secrets don't help the society. Secrets don't help anyone. Share your experiences. Share what you're doing. And maybe even support your local startups. That would be my last point. So thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.